Good morning, Mission Baptist. Happy Memorial Day weekend. We came today just to praise the Lord and to worship Him in spirit and in truth. And we just want to share a few words with you this morning, and just a prayer of sorts that we got wrote down here. I just want to share a few words with you concerning Memorial Day. With a sober heart, we come before you this Memorial Day. We pause for a moment and call to mind all the men and women who have died in service of our nation since 1776. We say to God, please look with mercy on our brave and selfless brothers and sisters who did not back down from their tasks, but gave themselves completely to the cause of defending and protecting us all. Bless all who have given their lives for the sake of liberty. We think about those family members that have lost a loved one in service to this nation. And today we also just want to say thank you. Thank you for your sacrifice also. Thank you for the sacrifice of your loved one in service to this nation. And because people has given of themselves since 1776, and has willing to go to bat for freedoms, the freedoms that we so enjoy today, is because of those individuals that we say today, thank you, and we honor you for your service to this country. We remember all those also that are the brave men and women now serving in our armed forces, both at home and abroad. Help them to discharge their duties honorably and well. And please bring them safely home, God, and to their families and to their loved ones. And bring peace and mercy to our troubled world that we're living in. And we most certainly realize that today, that this is a troubled world. We're living in a troubled nation at this point, and there's many. This Memorial Day is unlike any other Memorial Day that we've ever celebrated. But we do not want those people forgotten. And so we pause for a moment, and we're going to go to the Lord in prayer at this time. And we just want to say thank you so much for giving to this country so that we can come and worship this morning and have that freedom that we so enjoy every single week, being able to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. And so we're going to go to the Lord in prayer at this time and just ask a special blessing on the service today, a special blessing on our nation, a special blessing on those that's serving in all branches of our armed forces, both here and abroad. And also, we don't want to forget those family members that's without that loved one, that sacrifices month after month, and sometimes for long periods of time, they're without that loved one. And for those that have given the ultimate sacrifice and have laid down their lives for this country, we are so thankful, and we want to honor those family members that's missing that loved one also. So let us pray at this time. Our kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you, Lord. We do thank you, God, for, Lord, a time to pause and to say thank you to those individuals that have served in our armed forces, that have given their lives for this country, has went to war, have fought for our freedom, and God has laid down their lives, Lord, for the freedoms that we so enjoy today. God, we just we ask that you touch the hearts of the loved ones that's still living, the ones that have survived those that have given their lives. God, we ask that you just a special blessing be poured out on their lives today. And God, we thank you for the ones that are serving around the world today from this nation. We thank you for the ones that protect our borders, our seas, our shores, God. Each and every day, God, that put their lives in harm's way, God, that we can be free. And so, God, we just want to stop at this time and, God, just ask you to touch those people. God, we ask that you just, we ask you bless this nation, God. I know that we fall short in so many different ways, God. But, God, we are still a Christian nation. And, God, we want to worship you in spirit and in truth today. And, God, we ask that you, God, anoint the preaching of the Word of God today. God, we ask that you touch the singing this morning. I pray, God, that everything that's said and done in the service today will honor our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that laid down his life so that we may be spiritually free today. God, we love you today. We praise you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, and I pray that you have a safe and a happy Memorial Day weekend. Enjoy your time with your family and your loved ones. At this time, Ms. Courtney is going to open us up with a song of worship this morning. Thank you, Miss Courtney, for that wonderful song. You know, me and her don't often, we don't really talk about what she's going to sing, but that definitely goes right along with her message today, of being free from those shackles, from those burdens that so weight us down, and those shackles of sin. And when I came to Jesus, and Jesus, He drew me to Him. And God dealt with my heart, showed me the cross, showed me a Savior. And I realized that I was a sinner. That was me. And I needed a Savior. Those shackles just fell off. Thank God for the precious gift of salvation. So this morning, that's along the lines I was going to speak to you this morning. And the title of the message is Being Prepared for His Coming. And I know if you've been listening the last few weeks, we've discussed resurrection for several weeks now. And what wonderful time we had teaching on the resurrection. And last week we talked about those believers that are alive at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, at His coming to receive His church. Those that have died in Christ, we've discussed those over the last several weeks, but also those that will be living. There will be a generation living during the time of Jesus' return. And, you know, we think about that, and we think about all that's going on in our world today. And I think a lot of people are pondering those thoughts of the return of Christ. They're pondering those thoughts of this world coming to an end. And there's so many things in the media, so many things on social media that you are seeing daily. And I know, you know, we don't put a date on that time, but this is one of the most exciting times for the believer. You say, well, why is that, preacher? There's a lot of death going on right now. There's a lot of confusion, and people are losing their jobs. But, you know, we see this world headed towards that end that the Bible so has taught us. We've so studied, we've read that end, that point in time when God says, okay, son, go get your church, go get your bride. The things we've been preaching on from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the resurrection of the dead, the calling up, the church being caught up to meet the Lord in the air, and that setting into place, a set of wheels and sets in place at that trump of God we talked about last week, sets in place, and so begins the tribulation period and the millennial reign of Christ and the battle of Armageddon. All the things that we have taught in the church, we preached, and it's true. And this world is headed in that direction. So this morning I tried, you know, I studied and I looked at some different material to preach, some different things to preach, and I kept coming back to this subject here. And the thought that kept going through my mind over and over again is that there's many people that's not prepared for His coming. Many people are not prepared to meet God. And so we're going to go back this morning. We're going to share one springboard scripture from Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 27. So if you would, please get your Bibles out. As always, you need to see the scriptures as I read them. Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 27. As you are looking for that scripture and finding your place, I'm going to share a few opening thoughts here about being prepared. In this life that we're living right now, we are prepared for many events, and we get prepared for many events that take place in this life. We get prepared for birthday parties. There's certain preparations have to be made. We just celebrated Isaiah's 11th birthday, and we had to make preparations for that party to take place. We had to have cakes made. We had to get presents. We had to wrap them. We had to tell everybody to be here at a certain time. We had to prepare for that. When you get married, there's a lot of preparation goes into a wedding. So you prepare, you have to have a cake, a dress, and for many, many weeks, we actually prepare, if not years, prepare for a wedding. And even during this time, we're on this lockdown situation, I've heard of people they've postponed their wedding because of the situation that we're currently in. But, you know, there's a lot of preparation is made for a wedding. There's a lot of preparation made for an anniversary a lot of times, especially when it's like a 50th anniversary. You know, there's a lot of preparation that's made for that celebration. We prepare ourselves for it. If you live in North Carolina, at the first hint of somebody saying this, there's a chance of snow. If you live in North Carolina, you better run to Walmart because you won't find a loaf of bread or a gallon of milk in any grocery store. Why? Because people are preparing for the huge snow that's going to come. So that's North Carolina. When this pandemic, the announcement of this pandemic, and people started putting the word out there, guess what people did? They immediately started preparing. They started buying food. They started, I'm assuming that a lot of people somewhere has a lot of food somewhere. Somebody's got some food. And somebody's got a whole lot of toilet paper somewhere. I know they do. Because there's still none on the shelf hardly. It's empty every week. It's gone. And why is that? People feel the need to prepare for something. They feel as if something's going to happen. And whatever it is not going to be available to them. So they have to prepare for the events that's going to affect, they think, even the events they think is going to affect their lives. They prepare for that. They make preparations for that. And this is our thinking here as we live in this world, that I want to be ready for anything that life throws my way. We prepare, we put money in an emergency account. A lot of times we keep emergency cash. We prepare for something that comes in our life that's unexpected. It's just human. It seems like it's just in us, and we've been taught that we need to prepare for the unexpected in this life. So that was my thinking this week is I was thinking about life and I was thinking about different things that different events that I made preparation for. And then I kept going back to the resurrection and I kept thinking about the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And even after he comes and receives his church, and I was thinking about the tribulation period and I was thinking about the millennial reign and in a time when Jesus is going to return as to rule and reign and as Lord of Lords and King of Kings. There's a time coming when he's not coming as a meek and mild lamb for the slaughter. He's coming to rule and reign as a Lord and King. And we think about that. And that's what I hope you're preparing for. There's preparation that should be made for future events. Prophecy. There's a lot of prophecy being preached right now. There's a lot of things being talked about that's always been said to be in the future. And we the thing about it is those things can come unexpectedly. Death can come unexpectedly. You know, even in my family this week, see, that was unexpected that my mother's sister, that we would lose two people out of one family this week. You know, you think about that. A husband, a father, Justin Deals, his son, 11 years old. On this week, there was two caskets at the same funeral. Unexpected. We don't know. So that's why I want to speak to you this morning. And I want to speak to you as a believer. You may be sitting there and you say, well, I'm prepared. And praise God, I'm so thankful that you are. But what about your friends? What about your family? What about those that's closest to you? I keep coming back to this. When death approaches, when death overtakes you, those that are left behind, whether it be a mother, a father, a son, a daughter, an uncle, a grandma, a grandpa, an aunt, you know, it hurts. There's a breaking of the heart when there's a separation from one that you love, and that one is left behind. And you go to the grave. There's only one thing that is going to matter at that point in time. And there's only one thing that can bring peace to the heart of the one that's left behind. Is that they knew you was prepared to meet God. No doubt. No wonder. You let them know why you was alive, that I'm a child of God. I am born again. Jesus is my Savior and I love Him. And your life reflects that. Not just by your words, but your life reflects that you love His church. You love serving. So that's what I want you to stop and think about this morning. And if you are, think about the ones that you know. And you don't know whether they're prepared to meet God or not. Hebrews 9 says, Chapter 9, verse 27. And it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. And it is appointed unto man once to die, but after this, the judgment. Man is to die once. And in this same scripture, it tells us that we are held accountable for this life that we are living. There is a judgment. There is a day of reckoning. There is a day of judgment. There's a day that I will answer for this life in which I live right now. Many people think I'm living this life and I have nobody to answer to. I don't have, this is it. I just go to the grave. I dissolve. There's nothing else to after this life. And we know that's the biggest lie that's ever been told out of hell. There is life after death. There is a judgment. You only die once. But it's certain that you are going to die. It's a given. The only thing, as we shared with you the last several weeks, there's only one thing that will prevent you from experiencing death. And that is if you're a child of God, you're a born again believer, and when Jesus Christ returns, you are still alive. And you are caught up. We talked about it last week. Changed in a twinkling. In a twinkling. In a moment. Changed. Gone to be with Jesus for eternity. Now if that's you and Jesus returns, you will never experience death. But other than that, we are all going to go by the grave. You will not avoid death unless it's by the rapture. So this death is something that we are going to have to deal with. We're going to have to think about it. You know, this is what I'm afraid of. I'm afraid that we are spending all of our time in this life preparing for this life. Preparing for a long life here on earth. We have short-term plans. We have mid-term plans. We have long-term plans. We have retirement plans. We have all kinds of plans for this life. We have plans for where we're going to live. We've got plans for what we're going to do at this age. We've got plans for where we're going to retire at. We have all kinds of plans. And we're planning financially for those things. We're preparing for those things. So what I'm trying to get you to think about this morning is to think past this life. Think past this life. Think about eternity. Think about the preparation that needs to be made for eternity, for death. You need to prepare for death. You can't wait until you're dead and then say, well, I think I'll plan for it. It's too late. When you breathe your last breath, it's too late. Nobody can pray you out of any place. They can't pray you out of purgatory. That will not happen. There's nobody that can get baptized for you that is substitutes to get you into heaven. That will not happen. You must prepare for death now. There has to be preparations made. You're going to stand before God in one of two ways. You're going to stand before God prepared or unprepared. You're going to stand before God saved or you're going to stand before Him lost. There's only two conditions. God is only going to look at one thing. Do you know His Son? Have you prepared for death? So that's where we're getting at this morning. Turn to 1 John chapter 5 and verse 10. I'm going to read a couple of scriptures to you. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 10. How do you want to stand before God? And what's okay, preacher, what do you mean by being prepared? Maybe that's just the question that's in your heart. So number one, let's try to answer that. What do I mean by being prepared to meet God? Being prepared for death. Being prepared to stand in God's presence. Preacher, what do you mean by that? 1 John chapter 5 and verse 10. He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave His Son. And this is the record, that God hath given to us eternal life. And this life is in His Son. He that hath the Son hath life. And he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you, that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. First, notice in that scripture that he said, that he mentioned to us, to be prepared to stand before God, you have to have His Son. You have to know His Son. His Son equals life. You look in that scripture again. He that hath the Son hath life. And he that hath not the Son hath not life. And what life was he speaking of here? He says that God has given to us eternal life. And this life is in the Son. So the Son equals life. The Son equals life. I want you to get that this morning. And there is life after death. There is eternal life in His Son. So when we're talking about standing before God, it means that we stand before God, as verse 13 says, these things have I written unto you, that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. To stand before God prepared is to stand before God believing on the Son of God, that ye may know that you have eternal life. See, so some people say, well, you can't know this. You can't know that you have eternal life in the Son of God. But you can. The Scriptures clearly tell us here that you can know the Son, and you can know, by knowing the Son, you know that you have eternal life in the Son of God. And that's what He's proclaiming here in the Word of God. So to stand before God is to stand before God knowing the Son of God, and knowing, because you know the Son of God, you know you have eternal life in the Son of God. That's standing before God prepared. You're prepared to stand in God's presence. Why? Because you have believed and you know the Son of God. So, what do I believe in the Son of God? What do I believe about the Son of God? We said you're talking about believing in the Son of God and knowing the Son of God. So what should I know about the Son of God? What does it mean to believe in the Son of God? We go back to the scripture that we had taught you for several weeks, and that is 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And in those 58 verses that we spent several weeks on, we go back to the first three or four verses there. Go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And we'll start in verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel. The gospel, which I preached unto you, which also you have received, wherein you stand, by which ye also are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. And this is it. For I delivered unto you first of all that which also I received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures. So what do we believe about the Lord Jesus Christ? We believe that Jesus died for our sins. We believe that Jesus died for our sins according to the Word of God. We believe this. We believe that He was buried. We believe that Jesus was buried in that tomb. But we believe Jesus rose on the third day, and He's alive and well. Because He lives, so also shall I live and have eternal life, because I believe in the Son of God. Because I believe that He died on the cross for the sins, not just my sins, but for your sins and for the sins of the world. This is a worldwide redemptive plan for mankind, is that we can have salvation through the Son of God. We believe He died on the cross for our sins. We believe He was buried. We believe that He arose from the grave. That's what we believe, not according to what I say. That's according to the Scriptures. And it's important, because this is the inspired Word of God. God give us this Word. Man did not give us this Word. This is God's Word. This is God given. This is God breathed. The Scriptures is according to the Scriptures. It's not according to me. I'm just proclaiming the Scriptures. I'm proclaiming the gospel. The same gospel Paul preached is the same gospel I preach, according to the Scriptures. So what do I believe about the Son of God? This is what I believe. And you say, well, okay, what sins? Well, I'm a pretty good person. What sins? I mean, you know, I give to charities. I attend church. I've been a member of such and such church for 30 years. You know how many times I've heard that? I mean, you go to witness to somebody and you ask them, do you know Jesus Christ is your personal Savior? And the first words out of their mouth is, I've been a member of such and such church for 30 years. But do you know Jesus as your Savior? Well, I've been a member at such and such church for 30 years. I want you to understand this morning. Church membership will not save you. If you stand before God with your church membership, that is to stand before Him unprepared. Church membership will not prepare you to stand before God. Church membership will not prepare you for death. That's not it. Now, thank God we have churches. Thank God we have a group of believers that we can join together. I'm all for church membership. But church membership is not the gospel, and church membership will not save your soul. You've got to understand that today. This is it. He's talking about what sins. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All. All of us have. That's me. I realize that I'm a sinner. You can never be saved until you realize that you're lost. You'll never be saved until you realize that you're a sinner and that you need forgiveness of your sins. That you're in a place where you can't rescue yourself. And that's exactly the picture that we see. That you're drowning in your sins. And Jesus has reached down and He pulls you out. And He saves you gloriously. There's nothing I can do to save myself. All of us that are sinners before God. You know, all of us. And there's one thing that you do not want to do. You do not want to stand before God with all that unforgiven sin. That's to stand before God unprepared. Now, I'm not saying that any of us is perfect. By no means. Say, well, I know people in church, and I know we can point fingers. Listen, I'm the preacher, and I'm not perfect. But I know that I've trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ. I know that He is my Savior. I know I have been forgiven of my sins. And I know I battle just like you do. But when I stand before God, He's not going to look at what I did. He's not going to look at what I've done. He's going to look and see that I have trusted in the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that my sins has been covered by the blood of Jesus. There's nothing I can do to save myself. There's nothing I can do to keep myself. It's all by the faith in believing in the Son of God. It's all about the Son. It's nothing to do with me. I can't save myself from this sin. I can't rescue myself. We go back to the scripture I just read for you. What can we do about these sins then? What can we do? Remember what I just read to you. It said that Christ died. There in verse 3 in 1 Corinthians 15, it said Christ died for our sins. It wasn't what I did, it's what Christ did. Christ died. He came forth and He died for our sins. Now you have to remember that. That's what He did. That ain't what I did. That's what Christ did for me. He died in my place. He died on a cross for my sins and for your sins today. And that's what we just read in verse 3. And that might bring to mind the question, why would Jesus die for my sins? Why would Jesus die for me? He don't know me. Why would Jesus do this? And you know, there's no better verse in the Bible that sums this up better than John 3:16. For God so loved the world. That's it. That's the motivation. It's because God loved the world. God loved Pastor Ron. God loved you. You can put your name there. For God so loved you. So for God so loved the world that He did something. He gave His only begotten Son. He gave His Son because He loves you. I don't know if we really grasp that He gave His Son for you. And it goes on to say, for whosoever believeth in Him. It's for whosoever. It goes across racial barriers. There is no certain color. There is no certain religion. There is no certain individual. You don't have to be of a certain social status. You don't have to have a certain amount of money in your bank account. He died for whosoever would come and believe in the Son. And His wishes was that you should not perish, but that you would have again everlasting life. We see it again there in the Scriptures. I read it to you in 1 John, eternal life. And we see it in John 3:16, that there is everlasting life in Jesus. I don't know if you thought about that this morning, that God loves you that much. We go to Romans 5:8. But God commended His love toward us, and while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God loved us even when I was in this sinful condition. And when I was a sinner, God looked down and He loved me. And that's what Romans 5:8 tells us. It says, while I was yet a sinner, Christ loved me. And Christ died for us. That's the love that God, we can't comprehend. See, our love is conditional. If somebody doesn't do something we like, we think, well, I don't really like them. God's love is not based on conditions. God loved you in your sinful condition. See, that we can't get past that. This is God making a way for us to be prepared on that day we stand before Him. God said, He said, I'm making a way that you can come and believe on the Son and believe on Him dying on the cross for your sin. You can believe and put your trust in Him. That way you can stand before me prepared. That's what this is about. We choose God. And all of this is according to the Scriptures. See, there's so many beliefs in psychology out there, and man shares all of these ideas about death and life and all of those things. And people are being so deceived and misled by philosophy and things of that nature. But everything I'm preaching to you this morning, there is an absolute truth in this world today, and it's called the Word of God. And inside the Word of God is Scriptures. It is God breathed. So what I'm telling you today is not man-made. It didn't come from man. It come from God. And everything I've said is according to the Scriptures that I've read to you. Not me. It's what God said. God said, I love you in your sinful condition. So we come to Him and believe. Let me give you another 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, what does it mean to confess our sins? It means to come to God and say, God, I'm wrong and you're right. Yeah. I'm a sinner. I am unrighteous. And God, I need rescuing. To confess my sins before God. To say, God, I need you. I struggle with the flesh, God. I've tried to quit. I've tried to do this, and I've tried this, and I've tried that, and nothing seems to work. God, I'm still a sinner, and I need some help. If we confess our sins, according to 1 John 1:9, says that He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. God is faithful. I want you to just take that for a minute. God is faithful and He is just. I can't say that about me. That neither one of those words describe me. You say, really, preacher? Really? In the purest sense of the two words, faithful and just, only God can be faithful and just. Truly faithful and just. And He's faithful and just to forgive us. That means I don't have to worry about it. That's what it means. God's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. That's you too. And not just to do that, not just forgive us. But according to 1 John 1:9, He said He will cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Did He say all? Yes, He said all. All unrighteousness. That means He cleanses us. See, I don't even know if we understand what that means. When I confess my sins, say, God, forgive me. God in heaven, He doesn't look at me. He looks at the finished work of the cross. He looks at the shed blood of Jesus Christ. He looks at the sacrifice that was made on that cross for, what we say, according to 1 Corinthians 15:3, for our sins Christ died. He died on the cross for us, that our sins could be forgiven. And because of that, God says, I am faithful and just to forgive you of those sins, not because of what you did, but because of what my son did on the cross. And he said, because of what he did on the cross, he said, I am going to cleanse you of all unrighteousness. And what does that mean? That means that I stand before God as a believer, and I stand before God justified. He doesn't see my righteousness. He sees the righteousness of his son in me. But you get that. When you become a believer, at that very moment, the Holy Spirit of God indwells you. That's God. He sees that righteousness of his son. According to 1 John 1 and 9, my sins are forgiven. So, when I stand before God, God sees, I want you to get this. When I stand before God, God sees us with garments of salvation on and with a robe of righteousness. According to Isaiah 61:10, I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God. For he has clothed me with the garments of salvation, and he has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decketh himself with ornaments, and a bride is adorneth herself with jewels, prepared for the wedding. And that's the way God looks at you. When he looks at the believer, you've confessed your sin. You've come believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. God puts on, he clothed you in salvation. He puts on a robe of righteousness. What is he doing? He's preparing you for that wedding. He's making his bride ready. He's making his bride ready to present to his son a glorious church without spot and without blemish. That's prepared for the wedding. That's what that scripture says in Isaiah. That's because of the Lord Jesus Christ. You say, and what does that tell us? That's prepared. I stand before God prepared. You think, and this is where it gets me. This is the thought. I must have to do something. Nobody's never given me nothing free in this life. I have got to work for what I have. I've always had to work for what I've had. I still have to work for what I have. I have got to do something for this. Surely I must do something. You know, and I know that's the thinking. I've got to do something. And sometimes I feel like I got to do something just to give it back to God and say thank you. You know, I understand. But to understand this, Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. For by grace are you saved through faith. That is not of yourselves. It is a gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. And that's exactly what we do. If we could earn this salvation, if we could save ourselves, we would most certainly boast about it. That's for sure. But according to Ephesians 2, 8, for by grace are you saved through faith. It's not of yourself. There is nothing you can do to save yourself. It's by faith, and it's only through the grace of God that we can be saved. Romans 5, 1, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So your position before God is justified because of the finished work of Jesus Christ. And it, you know, in that scripture there in 5:1, it tells us that you have peace with God. I don't know if you know it at this point, but if you're lost and you're in your sin and you're not saved, you're an enemy to God. And there's only one way that you can have peace with God. There's only one way. There's one way. And that's through the Son, Jesus Christ. There is no other way to have peace with God. Any other way, you'll stand before God unprepared. If you're going to be prepared, you must go through the Son. It's got to be through Ephesians 2, 8. It's got to be through 1 John 1, 9. We've got to confess our sins. We've got to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. There is no other way. If anybody preaches another gospel, the Apostle Paul said, let them be damned. There is only one gospel. There's only one Savior. And His name is Jesus. And that's the only way you'll stand before God prepared. Any other way, you'll be standing there empty-handed. Nothing. So what does that mean to stand before God unprepared? Unprepared. Matthew, we read you a couple scriptures and we'll close it down. Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 through 23. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of the Father which is in heaven. Many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have I not prophesied in thy name? In thy name have I not cast out devils? In thy name have I not done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. You sinner. And that's one of the most scariest verses in the Bible. That's that right there. I mean, these people did I not cast out devils in thy name? Did not do many wonderful works in that name? There's going to be many people and that's going to stand there and say, since I was a child, did I not attend every single church service? I'm a member at such and such church. And I'm serious. I can see it before the throne of God now. They're going to stand there and try to plead with God and say, didn't I do this? Did you not see me do this? Did I not give to the poor? Did I not make shoeboxes? Did I not come to the church service? Did I not give to the food pantry? Surely that will get me in heaven. I'm a good person. And he's going to say in this scripture, depart from me. I never knew who you were. Those are the most scary words I've ever heard. To have God, the God of heaven, say, depart from me. I don't know you. That's standing before God unprepared, church. And we got people in our families that's unprepared. We got loved ones that's unprepared. And we know the truth of the gospel. We ought to be ashamed of ourselves today for what we know. And we keep it hidden under a bushel. This is the last days. We're moving towards that coming of Christ. Do not be deceived. Jesus is coming and he will come and get his children. And that will set into motion some gears that will not be stopped until this is done. We better prepare, church. Let me give you one more. And I think it's one of the some of the most saddest scripture in the Bible. First, I want to share with this Romans 14:11. For it is written, as I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, every tongue shall confess to God. In verse 12, so that every one of us shall be given account of himself to God. Everyone shall give an account of himself to God. I just wanted you to, as I read this last scripture in Revelations, I just wanted you to know that if you're sitting there still today and you're doubting whether you're going to stand before God, whether you're going to give an account of this life, once again, the scriptures tell us again that every man, woman, child, every human being that's ever lived on this earth will stand before God and they will bow a knee and they will give an account of the life that they lived here. They'll give an account of what they did with this man named Jesus. No exceptions. I don't care if you're the richest man. I don't care if you're a king. I don't care if you're a pauper. It does not matter. Every single person. So if you have any doubt, throw that out. That's Satan. So, Revelation 20. It's come down to this. The church has already been raptured. Already been through the tribulation. We've been through the millennial reign of Christ. It's time for the final judgment of the lost. It's time for every knee to bow before God and give an account. And I saw a great white throne, Revelation 20 and verse 11. And him that sit on it, from whose face in earth and heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which was in it. And death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into a lake of fire. And this is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. This is the scriptures that is absolutely true. Whosoever's name was not found in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. All the dead, all the living, stand before God. These are the people that stood before God unprepared, in a lost condition. They rejected the Lord Jesus Christ in the finished work of Calvary. Now listen. If you've got somebody in your family, you're afraid to tell them. You need to get them to listen to this message. You need to put it before them. They need to know that this thing is coming to an end. And they need to get prepared for death or for the rapture. Remember, I told you at the start of the message, you'll stand before God in one of two conditions. You either stand before Him prepared, covered by the blood of the Lamb. Jesus is my Savior. I put my trust and my faith in the Scriptures. I put my faith and trust in the finished work of Calvary. Or you'll stand before God at this great white throne judgment. You remember I said that. You will stand before God according to the Scriptures at this great white throne, and you'll be unprepared. At this point, it'll be too late. You'll be cast into a lake of fire with Satan and his angels, and there you'll remain for eternity. Nobody will pray you out. You will not climb out. There is no secret passage. There is no escape route. That it will be your eternal destination for rejecting the salvation plan that God prepared for you. That's pretty rough, preacher. Listen, church, this is to you. During this time, we're running here and there. We're busy. We're doing this and that. Okay? I get it. But church, we need to stay focused. There's a gospel that's been handed to you as a precious nugget for you to give out to all those that God sends your way. That sends past you. You want to stand before God with their blood on your hands. Let's put it to you that way. We will give an account with what we did with the gospel. Praise God I'm saved. Thank God I'm saved. But you still will give an account with what you did with the gospel. That's scary. That's scary. Church, we've got to stay focused. I know all the politics. I know all the stuff that's going on. I know everything's being said about church and meeting and this and that. But we got to stay focused on the mission. God has called us to spread the gospel. Tell somebody about Jesus. I pray that you're prepared to meet Jesus. I pray that you're prepared to share Jesus with the ones that are unprepared. Let us pray. Kind and gracious Heavenly Father, God, I thank you for the gospel. God, I give this message just as you give it to me. God, is convicting to me. God, I got to stay focused on what you've called me to do. God, forgive us of our sins. Forgive us of our shortcomings. Most of all, God, I pray for the one that's listening to this message that's lost. God, this is serious business. I pray that they take their eternal destination very serious at this moment. I pray that they repent of their sins and they turn to Jesus and come in faith, believing on the Son of God and the finished work of Calvary. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, if we can help you in any way, listen, Mission Baptist is always open. Feel free to call me at any time. Shoot me an email. Send me a text. Any way you want to contact us. You can check our website out at missionbaptistnc.net. And you just shoot me an email, whatever you need to do. We're glad to talk to you about your salvation. Thank you, and we'll see you on Wednesday night. God bless.